I decided to talk this morning a bit on how difficult everybody makes the teaching material to themselves. It's really very simple, but seems like everybody wants to make it into a very deep, big problem.
Yeah, read that. That'll show them. That'll
do you. Okay, here's BC, says Guru. Why can't the guy get an office like anyone else? He's climbing a mountain. And, oh great Guru, why is there so much misery in the world? Guru said, who's miserable? I'm not miserable. Are you miserable? Yes. Why? That's what I'm trying to find out. So, everybody makes themselves miserable over going to do the right thing, and they work hard and they struggle. Well, I've noticed that most people have two things they pursue. They pursue feeling sorry for themselves, or they pursue being a victim. They're very related. But most people like to be a victim. So they struggle, and then they can self-pity because I've studied the teaching material in here after so many years. I'm still in the same place I was. And all those good things, which we feel is totally unnecessary because the teaching material is very simple. You simply let things be. And when you let them be, you don't get all agitated. You're quiet and peaceful, and that's the nature of the teaching, is to get to a place of peace. Is that right? So when I just let it alone, I'm peaceful, but I'm not trying to feel miserable. I'm not trying to feel sorry for myself. I'm not trying to be a victim. Both of those leaves one feeling pretty bad. And there's no reason for anyone else. So somebody says, hey, today work so hard. Well, if you're working hard, you're not being peaceful. That's right. Simple, easy. Take it as it comes. I see a little bumper sticker every once in a while that says, easy does it. Well, that's pretty well what it does. Easy does it. I'm not struggling. I'm not straining. I'm not struggling about anything. And I feel very peaceful. What else is there to feel when you're just taking things easy as they come along? Huh? So, let's take the teaching material simply and easily. Let's don't make it into some big project that you've got to work day and night and watch yourself with an eagle eye and find fault with everything you do and want to go back. Let's just let it be. And if you don't make anything important, which is not necessary, why not just let it be? If you don't make it important, you feel pretty nice inside. Do you ever notice that, or do you always make everything important?
Seldom
notice that point of not making it important. So, let's put up here that it's not important.
It's not important. It doesn't work. It's not important.
No, it's not important. It's still, okay? Oh, yeah, it works. So, there's always something else you can do to pick up and make something worthwhile. Now, about everything in this world is interesting, I find. About everything. It may not be interesting to me at this minute, but it's interesting to somebody at this minute. So, when I'm interested in things, I feel real good. When I'm making it important, I'm miserable, right? So, let's just make things simply what they are. They're very interesting, and interest you don't have to struggle with. If you're interested in going to the parade today, you can go to the parade, and it's simple and easy. If it's important to get there and you're in a turmoil by the time you got up in the morning, you want to be that way until the parade's over. And by that time, you'll find something else to make important. So it's not important whatever comes along that we do. Hello, Miss Diane. How are you?
Sorry, I was supposed to be late. I'm late.
Well, no. I'm early. So, we started 15 minutes early.
Good, because I heard you had set 9 and said you never started till 10.
That's right. So, I finally gave in and started at 9:45. Okay. So, that's easy enough. It's not important anyway. What time we start, so we'll start when we did, and it'll get along all right. And you're not late, you're early. So, when you make things important, you are anxious. We have a little statement that says, whenever I make anything important, I am anxious. Now, you can repeat that over and over and over thousands of times, and it'll do absolutely nothing for you, except it took up a little time. But if you really made something interesting and not important, 1 minute, you have done a tremendous amount of work. And it really was no effort whatsoever. And nothing to get anxious about or struggle with or listen to tapes 24 hours a day or any of that kind of stuff. It's just something you did, and that has an effect. What you do with teaching material is what's important, worthwhile, or interesting, or anything else. It is not struggling with it. So let's put all struggle to the side today, will you please? And it might be fun, so if you put it aside today, you can put it aside forever. So let's put all the struggle and the effort aside. Okay, I'd like this talk to be discussions as much as possible instead of lectures. So is there any comments on this, what we just said? Comments? Not important comments, just interesting ones. Yes?
Where does study come into this?
Study? Mm-hmm. When it's kind of interesting to read something or listen to something or something. When it's interesting, not because it's important. Okay. Maybe some morning you don't have something to do, so you turn on something and you listen to it and you are studying it, listen to it, simply because it's interesting to you. Okay? Is that all right? Okay. Other question, comment? It won't have to be a question, it'll be a comment. Just share your comment. Okay.
Do you ever know if you've got this?
You know, when you feel wonderful all the time and you're not going through anxieties, okay, how's that? That's a pretty good indication you're doing all right when you feel wonderful and not a bundle of anxiety. Is that all right? Okay, I've got it for a minute whenever I'm feeling all right. I've got it for an hour if I feel all right for an hour. I've got it all day if I don't get anxious all day. I don't see any reason to be in anxiety or conflict or struggle anywhere. Do you?
It'd be nice not to be.
Well, you want to try it? Just don't make anything important. You'll find you get along all right all day long, okay? It doesn't make an importance as to what somebody does. Carpenter made a little boo-boo. There's no use falling apart. Just show it to him and he'll fix it, okay? Huh? Is that all right? Good. Okay. Any more? Yes, ma'am.
I was just thinking this would be a great attitude to share with our children.
That's
so
correct.
They are so critical, and then they get a whole life, a whole menu, a whole diet of criticism.
Right. Are all things important? You teach them to be a victim, or you teach them to self feel sorry for themselves right away?
At a point in mind, my daughter, she's going to graduate from high school in June, first of June, and she's so concerned about her friends, they're getting scholarships, they're applying for them, and she's wondering what she's doing. And I said, Tennessee, don't worry about it, you know. Just kind of take it as it comes.
Right.
This anticipation can really cause
anticipation along. Here it comes. My little daughter was in a science fair recently. So she made herself up a project, and she put it down. She said, well, nobody will be interested in it. And I said, well, they probably will be. But she got first prize in it. So she's going around telling everybody how to get things first prize. Just work hard and forget it. So I don't know whether she forgot it or not, but that's what she's telling everybody. So she just work hard and forget about it. All right, you get first prize in. Okay, anybody else got a comment? Okay, well, knock this one off the board. You can come back to it whenever you want to, okay? Now, as much as the lady said, what we teach kids is kind of things. Now, I've noticed that you don't really teach kids a lot. You demonstrate a lot of things, and they pick it up. You know, they learn the language without any big effort. You just went on talking, and they picked it up, right? They mimic you. So they mimic about everything you do. So if you want them to have fits and have all kinds of big noises, why, you go around and show that for them. You have struggles and anxieties and worries, and they will pick it up. If you go along and don't make things important, so they spill something, so what? You can wipe it up. You don't have to throw a fit. And they pick that up as a central attitude towards life. Possibly one way of saying what teaching material is all about is that it's a central attitude towards life. That seems to be a reasonable way of going at it. It's a gentle attitude. You don't have to make struggles out of everything or anything's important. You just take it easy. And being easy to life is very worthwhile. So it's a gentle attitude towards living. And living comes every day. There's usually a little resistance in everything. So it'll go away. If it don't, why, you can overcome it. It's so simple. If you don't overcome a resistance today, it'll still be around tomorrow and pick you up, so what's the difference? And you can take a gentle attitude towards living, towards all life. And it's a very simple thing to do and very interesting to do, and you have an utter delight in everyday living there. No matter what's going on, you just have a gentle attitude towards it. It won't disappear. It don't have to be done this minute. It don't have to be done today or what have you. Now, in order to look at some of the things we could take a gentle attitude, let's take the picture of man. That's something we can all be reminded of gently. So let's take a little look-see at it. A man has four major aspects. He has physical body, he has an awareness, and he has something we call X, and he has a function always of some sort or other. He's at least breathing if he's with us. Now he lives in an environment. The environment sends in impressions. Awareness has an impression. It changes that into a feeling. The feeling goes to X, and X does the appropriate thing through the physical body. It always takes care of the appropriate thing for the information it received from feeling. So this is down to the physical body. An impulse, we'll call it. And that results in a function. Now that works just as simple as 1, 2, 3 all day long. Works easy. Don't have to put any struggle in it. It's there. So the only thing we pay really attention to is what kind of a feeling do I get about the various input we get from the environment. And that's not important or struggle or anything. It's simply interesting is that I form a feeling about everything that comes in from the environment. Now, if a person was like this, you'd work wondrously. Wouldn't ever be making things important. He wouldn't feel he's a victim, wouldn't feel he was a self-pity or anything of the sort. He'd just function. But as we've looked, he's got some things we call conditioning in there. So the first one was the whole purpose of living. Is to regain. The non-disturbed state. Now, of course, the big disturbance is inner conflict. And, of course, we have physical discomfort. Physical discomfort, first thing to do is get it comfortable as quick as you can. So, this is the purpose the infant has. And it's a passable one, but nevertheless, it's there. It's according to what happens to it. So, the first way the infant decided to obtain the non-disturbed state was to complain. That says he's a victim or he's in need of self-pity. Now, I hear people work on complaining. They notice they complain. So they're going to not complain. So they work very hard not to complain. And of course they're complaining all the time while they're doing it. But the interesting thing is to see that I do complain. Just simply, that's a fact. I complain a lot. Now, we don't do anything about that. We just see it. When you see the fact of something, it changes. Necessarily in 1 minute, but it'll change in very shortly. So, you see, I complain a lot. Next day, I complain a lot. Next day, next hour, I complain a lot. So, pretty soon, by seeing that, you cease complaining. It begins to get less and less, and it quits in a while, because you just look at it. I'm complaining a lot. Now, the next thing that comes along is the person sticks up for their rights. Sometimes that's an inside job, it's not outside. Now, that's another one. You can't by willpower force yourself not to stick up for your rights. But you can simply state the cold fact, I'm sticking up for my rights a lot. And I get to feeling sorry for myself, and I feel I'm a victim because I don't have my rights. Now, I really don't know what rights are. Do you come to think of it? I don't know that a human has a right one. We arrived in this world helpless, broke, hairless, toothless, couldn't eat, left very fine little food, etc. And we go around talking about our rights. I don't know if we have any. We were totally dependent when we got here. About as totally dependent as we were, and couldn't make a contribution. So, I don't see that we have any rights, but it's all right. I'm going to state that I'm always sticking up for my supposed rights. So, we repeat that every now and then when it comes up. We notice it. Not difficult, not hard, just plain, simply state the fact. I'm sticking up for my rights. Well, you find yourself doing that a few times and you recognize it, it quits. You just simply can't keep on doing it when you recognize it. Now, most of the time, we've never recognized that in all my life, just like we didn't recognize that we were complaining. We didn't recognize it. So we didn't report it. We didn't state it simply as that. Now, as the child grows up a little more and his folks begin to raise him up in the way that he should go, you know, they don't provide him with an example of something. They provide him with wisdom. They tell him how it ought to be while they're doing something different. So this one says that I must like them. That means all the people who's always telling him what he ought to do and telling him how bad he is if he don't. Well, now that brought about a conflict between sticking up for my rights and pleasing them and complaining and pleasing them. So that's come down and split the way. It's the way to get to be non-disturbed was split it down the middle. So now this one works one way and this one works another. We'll call this one A and this one B. Okay? So now then, I have a big conflict. Every time something comes up, shall I complain or stick up for my rights or shall I please them? Tell them how well I like them and everything. Now that puts you in a conflict. Big internal conflict. Now that's painful. No matter how big it is or how little it is, internal conflict is painful. So, here's another case we can see. I'm in conflict over something that's very unimportant. I'm in conflict. So we just simply report that repeatedly, a few times. Nothing urgent about it, just simply. I'm aware of it. It's simple as anything we can come about with. And the conflict will begin to cease. It'll split this wall down. Now, the next one that comes up is urgent to do something right. It's important. To be different. Now, how are you going to be different than what you are? What you are. So, simply, report that you feel you ought to be different. And it goes away pretty soon. Now, the next one that comes up as we get a little older is that I must improve myself. Now, trying to improve yourself is kind of funny. Because you have all the talents and everything in the world. You are what you are, and you vary from moment to moment. And there is really nothing that should be improved. You merely state the fact on these over here without trying to improve them. No effort on that, just stating them. You see it, the truth. It's called knowing self. No effort, no struggle, no big deal about it. It's just doing it. So if you improve that, you report frequently, I'm trying to improve myself every time you think you should. And I really wouldn't know how. I don't know how to improve a human being. Should you put another head on their shoulders? Should you put another arm somewhere? Should you put another foot somewhere or two of them or something? It really, we're pretty good, well put together. Pretty well put together. Somebody or something with a lot of thought put it together and it works. So I can't improve on it, but I can see that I'm trying to improve all my little statements inside. I've tried to improve myself by not complaining. I've tried to improve myself by not sticking up for rights. I've tried to not feel out to like people and so forth. But these are all coming. So we just simply report, I feel I ought to improve myself. And gradually that urge disappears. Simply and easily. No big conflict. Yes.
Is your health of trying to improve, say you were diagnosed
First off, we leave the diagnosis off.
Well, but they can find cancer or something.
Okay.
And they diagnose it. Can your feelings reverse this diagnosis?
Sometimes has been known to, if they really reverse it. Most often they make more anxiety out of it. Okay? Most people get more anxious when they've been diagnosed as having cancer or something else.
Something brought that cancer there in the first place, say.
You have a lifetime of making everything important. Okay? That look reasonable? But
yes.
Okay, they had plenty of reason to develop anything over the period of years because they've been working at it desperately. Even trying to be a better person. Okay? You're all right like you are. Just recognize what's there. Don't try to change it, okay? And your health will pretty well take care of itself. Or in accidents and such things, you'll get along pretty good. Okay? All right? Long enough. And you don't have to sit and worry, what if I'm getting old? What if I'm going to die sometime? What if I'm going to do this? What if I'm going to do that? I expect you'll die sometime. Most people have, I've noticed, lived a long time. Now, the final one is that if he, she, they, etc., we're all different. I'd be okay. Now that's when you really get down to being a good solid victim. You see, if all these other people would just straighten up and fly right, I would be wonderful. Now, I don't know where you've ever found a time when everybody was treating you all right or not. But that's the fundamental idea, and so the fundamental idea keeps it going, that if everybody were different, I'd be fine. Now, you're not going to find everybody different. They're going to be what they are. They've already stated, if you want to make yourself a victim out of that, you can easily do so. But you don't need to, okay? You get along fine with the world like it is. Now, once in a while, you may find somebody you don't particularly care for. You can just put a little distance between them and you. Isn't that right? Hmm? Now, usually we hand up somebody that's close to us and feel they ought to be different. And then we can't get away. And the whole point is we can make ourselves very miserable over them. Now, you can simply report it. I'm acting as though if everybody else were different, I'd be all right. I'm acting out the victim role, you might say. Okay, just put it in that. I'm playing the victim role. And if you repeat that a few times, you'll find you're not being the victim as much. You can go ahead and let little things slide. Everything works well and you don't have to get all agitated about things. Is that right?
Sounds good.
Well, would you like to do it? Just report it. I'm playing the victim role. See? And you will find that the victim role disappears in a while. Okay? You're not doing it. Yes, sir.
You just call me John or something.
Yeah, I will.
Making things important, if we became convinced that what you're saying is really real and we internalized it and did it, then of course none of us would show up to the meeting. But
oh, you might, because it's interesting.
No, yeah, it'd be interesting. Where does the conflict get settled between wanting to do something that's kind of like, take for example, going to medical school?
Mm-hmm.
Sometime in your life, if you're going to be a doctor, you have to spend you spend all your time, become intense about it, and it really is important. And then sometime you end up doing something, it's a business, ultimately.
Yeah.
And it's one of your great games, as you say. But
so,
you're making, in some way, you make a contribution, but you can't make that contribution without having made that thing important at one time.
Oh, I think you can make it if you made it very interesting to go to school. Okay?
Well, it is interesting. There's
well,
no,
that's
no
what
doubt
you
about that.
Because it's interesting, and because what you, it was, the material you were learning was interesting, and you could see where it had an interest for years. So, I went through that little stage, and I went through the business of being anxious about it till I found out, wait a minute, this isn't worth it. And I made it interesting, and it was kind of fun from there on. And I made just as good grades. I made as many A's as I did when I was struggling at it morning, noon, and night. Okay? So, I think you can get along with making things interesting, sir. And you could see that I'm making this important, and it's really very interesting. Okay? I see how that would work. You can't do it over again, but you can apply it somewhere around that you make everything interesting instead of very important. I think that would work. Okay? Now, you report. Don't try to make something not important when it seems important to you. You merely recognize it clearly. I'm making this very important. And you'll find that it ceases and you can begin to make it interesting. Now that's what we mean by that. You don't have to work and struggle and strain and things on the teaching material. It is a fact of recognizing what you are inside. Now, that's fairly simple if we just take this little picture and kind of go through these now and then. We can see where they are not all important. They are interesting, and when you're interested, you have a very different life than when you're making everything important. That you've tried a few times that something was interesting to you. Is that right? Was it a big struggle? Until you remembered to make it important. Huh? Okay, now we'll say let's have some questions and comments on this. We've got a lot of material here now. Yes.
Okay. Sometimes I see this and I think, okay, now if I don't complain and I don't stick up for my rights and I don't please anybody, I'll be aware and awake and wonderful. And pretty soon I blow up and then I see everybody
you
else.
You didn't report that simply you were doing these things, you said, if you didn't do them. In other words, you were trying to improve yourself.
Yeah, I take it as an improvement.
Well, let's don't fiddle with the improvement. Let's report what is there simply, without trying to think I'm improving myself or anything of the sort. Okay? The fact works all the difference, and it's no struggle. Okay? Yeah.
Something just came to mind when we say, make you think interesting. What if we go one step farther and say, let things be interesting? Sometimes the
same
make,
difference. Let be interesting. Some things are not interesting to you, just let them be. Mm-hmm. Okay. Uh-huh. But if it's of reasonable interest to you that you would ordinarily make important, just report that it's you're making things important and it'll quit. Okay? Because that's knowing yourself. Okay, another comment, question? Yes, sir.
In my practice, I see a lot of injuries, and
mm-hmm.
a lot of people that have accidents and
yeah.
been hit by cars and
fall off of airplanes.
Yeah,
all
those things, sure.
All sorts
exactly.
of things.
All those things. It all happened yesterday. Every one of those things happened.
Yeah.
But I find myself. You take care of the problem. It's interesting. It's very fascinating, and it's
right.
always very
challenging.
Right. And yet you get caught. You make yourself interested in it, but then the next step is that then you get caught in the other person's making it important, making it standing up for their rights.
Mm-hmm.
With the current situation, like with insurance, for example.
Yeah.
in order to help the patient get to the hospital, even to get care, or whatever has to be done, then you have to struggle and resist and fight with the insurance companies. And so I have a whole staff that's struggling, resisting, fighting with the insurance companies all day long. Now, I try to stay out of that, but then they're still involved in it. And the patients get involved in it. Right. And so what I find is that I'm one step away. I'm ending up with a whole system fighting and struggling and resisting and making important for other people in order for them to get their rights and sticking up for their rights, you see.
Okay.
And how do you run a business? You've run a business before.
Still have.
Yeah. How do you run a business without getting involved in this struggle and resistance for other people in order to make the whole thing function? It's somewhere.
Yeah.
The money has to come in. You have to pay your employees.
All that kind of stuff.
And if you don't struggle with insurance companies, the patients don't get to the hospital, get their surgeries that have to be done, or whatever. You know, it's a war out there.
On the insurance company.
Well, yeah, sure. You're right, exactly. It's all their fault.
Yeah. So I would just fill out the form simply and easily, or get it filled out. I wouldn't do it. That's too much hassle. Somebody to fill it out and let them take care of it. I wouldn't get involved. I just don't get involved in insurance plans.
Oh, yeah, I try that. And people, maybe I just buy into it. But the people, they all think that it's now your responsibility to get the insurance in.
Yeah, it's all up to the doctor to get the insurance.
Yeah, nothing is their responsibility.
Oh, no. Everybody
almost every patient that comes in, it's your responsibility or somebody else's fault that this has happened.
Yeah, naturally. So they all want to be victims and they all want to be. So
they
report they're playing victim. And I'm about to get to play myself a victim role. And so then I just let that report it and go on about my business and find it goes around. Okay? You don't get involved in all these things and make it important. All anxious and struggle, you merely report that's what you're doing, is that you are sticking up for the patient's rights, you're fighting this big ogre, the insurance companies. Right?
Yeah.
Yep, I'm fighting them. It's not doing any good, but I'm fighting them. I don't see any reason to fight with them now. Fill out their little forms and let them be. Easy enough. Don't get struggled in it. You can report, I'm about to be a victim here. I am playing a victim role here, and it will cease. You don't stop it now by willpower, because that'll put you in a conflict that is really a conflict. Report simply with the situation as it is. Be sure I'm looking at it straight. Okay?
I'll keep trying.
Okay. Not trying, just doing it. Yes,
yeah,
Marlene.
Yeah.
Is spirit acts totally?
Oh, yeah, it does, yeah.
All right. So it's only doing the appropriate
thing
response
for the information
for what we feed. So
yeah.
If we feed spirit anything, including I don't feel, the statement, well, I don't feel well, is spirit then saying, right, you don't feel well, because
and
that's what you're saying.
It, right? It'll do the appropriate thing for the information you give.
All right. So every single thing then we report to a neutral divine, to a neutral.
Absolutely
divine.
Neutral. It doesn't care what's
all right,
on.
Then this divine is going to act on exactly what we're saying.
That seems to be
then
correct.
You can change the universe.
But I've never been able to see why, when you report, like she said, I don't feel well, why X doesn't go to work to make you feel well. It doesn't work that way.
No, just the opposite. It works just the opposite. I feel well, and then X says, yes, you feel well.
So you can say, I couldn't be better, top of the world, whatever. You can say, I couldn't be better. And you really couldn't be, or you were already with me, so that's reporting pretty accurate. So you're not lying or fibbing, you're saying. Because I say to people every once in a while, somebody says, how are you? And I say, top of the world. I wish I could say that. Well, it's true. truth right down the line. No matter how I'm feeling, it's the best I can do right now. That's the way it is. So I'm saying it couldn't be better.
Things backwards.
Huh?
Things backwards.
No, it's not.
So
you complain. Spirit says that's fine. So you say, I'm complaining about how I feel. And that'll get something done. You're looking at how you are functioning. And it is reporting accurately, and that seems to put a stop to all this stuff. So you can always say, I couldn't be better. Because if you could be, you'd already have been this minute, is that right? Okay, so you can tell everybody, you couldn't be better. Okay? But you can't get to be a victim that way, you see.
Yeah.
Hmm? You don't play an organ recital.
Take too long.
So how about just telling everybody it could be better for a while, okay?
Okay.
Let's see what happens, okay?
And then X acts upon that.
Yeah. Fixes you up where you can be better. That's right.
You sure he doesn't stop working?
Huh? No, never knowing it stopped. That's what you are in here. The only way it stops is you depart this life. So I listen to people talk, and once in a while somebody begins to see something, and they tell me how they got certain things going. You know, it just is an interesting thing. Okay, any other comments? Yes, Theora.
Well, you can, to me, I can say that I feel fine, but the feeling is being is doing the reporting, isn't it?
Yeah, it's the feeling doing the reporting, so you only report accurately. We didn't say you said you was feeling fine, did it?
Isn't saying top of the world, saying you're feeling fine.
No. This means you're sitting on top of the world. You see where your feet are. Huh? I'm saying I couldn't be better. So what? That's a fact. I couldn't be doing better. Now, I'm not going to lie and say I'm feeling wonderful. I just said I couldn't feel better. Okay? I want to report to X accurately and exactly. All right? So I'm not going to fib and say I'm feeling wonderful when I'm hurting. I'll say I couldn't feel better. Couldn't be better. Top of the world. Okay? I'm sitting on top of the world right now. Yes, ma'am. Any other questions?
Yeah, would you report that like the body hurt, would you say that, or would that be?
Well, I would rather report it a little more obtusely, was saying I couldn't feel better.
Okay.
If I tried to report all the discomforts that I could experience, and I started paying attention to them, it'd take me forever to get it told. I'm not going to do that one, okay?
Okay.
Do it quick and easy, yes, Connie.
If we keep ourselves in bondage with these decisions, and then the next step is the person beside us acting on, you know, we're hearing, is our going along with this is also contributing to the delinquency.
Yeah, a little bit.
What's a statement we could use? What's something if someone's just complaining, even to their doctor? What is it we can respond?
I make cooing sounds, but not listen.
Okay. Not yes, you. We make them also a child of hell by agreeing.
Right.
By saying,
so
oh,
I
yes,
just make cooing sounds and let them sound off and be done with it. Okay.
Example.
Yeah. That'd be. I just not going to get caught up in other people's.
But also not agreeing.
Huh?
But also not agreeing.
No, I'm not going to agree with them or disagree. I just let them sound off. Okay? Hey, there's an end sound. Diana?
There's a woman I work with, and I don't care how little it is or how big it is. Oh, really? Oh, you don't say. Is that so? That'll work.
Uh-huh. That's right. Like, dear Bunny and down in Arizona would tell people when they tried to give her a big number, she'd say, I'm impressed. It worked real well, too. I'm impressed. Okay? Yeah.
When this is cleared out, that line in your parable here, when this is cleared out, does that line across the top evaporate?
You mean this
between
one?
Between the divine and
Christ. Well, it's always body. Evaporated. You can always get across. It takes it where you tell it to fib or where you tell it straight or whatever. It's always got holes in it. It's always holy. Okay? No, the awareness is one function, the X is another one, and the physical body is another one. So there's always a slight demarcation there, but they've got lots of holes in them so that it goes through. Okay? It's not ironclad. Yes?
Okay, when we have the conflict between A and B,
it
causes anxiety and fear.
It causes all sorts of noises, yeah. Natural reaction to it.
Okay, and then this in turn can manifest into physical.
Manifestations and mental ones and spiritual ones and so forth, yes.
Okay, so when we get into this physical, when we've got to the point where we're hurting physically, we just need to report that and it will dissipate.
Yeah, it'll usually get gone if it's not an accident or something. Yes, it'll get gone. But, rather not get there. If you get there, I report accurately, I'm in conflict. And you quit being in conflict, Vincent.
So you don't really need to know what you're in conflict
about?
No,
it doesn't matter. Just so you know that you're feeling conflict. Okay? And you can report it accurately, that's what it is, and you will quit making the conflict. See, we kid ourselves that we don't have conflict and we don't have this, we don't have that, but we do have them. And when we look at it, we can state it accurately, then you quit, believe it or not. Okay? X doesn't do that, you do it.
Why do we have to report? Doesn't X know what's going on?
X doesn't matter, this is something you do. So you want to state it out loud so you can see it.
This
is something awareness does. It quits doing that when it sees clearly what it's doing. X doesn't do it, X careless. It just goes on and does its thing, okay? Okay? Another comment, question, anyways? Yes, sir.
Ultimately, pain is wherever the stimulus comes from is felt or observed really only at the upper few cells of the cerebral cortex.
Right.
And if you can learn to dissociate that pain from whatever it is causing it, then you can diminish it or make it disappear in most instances.
If you want to do that.
There are, I've had pain myself. Everybody that comes to my office has pain, as an orthopedic surgeon, virtually.
Right.
It's what drives them into my office, or in the emergency room, or whatever. A lot of it's brought on by themselves, of course.
Correct.
Saw three kids yesterday that fractured their arms real badly from skateboarding, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, they could avoid that, but then they had real pain once that it comes on.
Right.
But the I've had pain myself where I took an anti-inflammatory medicine and the pain went right away. Now, I guess I could sit and contemplate on that, not associating that pain, but there is real pain that occurs.
That's right, and we're very aware of that. We say, by all means, keep the physical body as comfortable as possible. Okay?
You know, is that making it non-disturbed? To kind of pay attention to that pain and
the real disturbance you're trying to avoid is the internal pain. After all, if you
the emotional pain you're talking.
Yeah, if you fall down, break your arm, or break your leg, or fracture your neck, get as comfortable as quick as possible. You need the body to be reasonably comfortable in order to function well.
So then you need orthopedic surgeons in this society,
oh, sure,
right?
Sure.
Oh, thank you.
We need orthopedic surgeons so they can straighten out the thing that was all torn up. Right. Right.
He just needed you to say that. He's
well,
been
all right,
waiting
I'm
all year for
out
you to say
that. You definitely need repairmen.
I didn't hear it on your tape, so I just had to get on that.
Well, you need a repairman when you got something all banged up, okay?
No, I wasn't looking for an accolade. I just, actually, pain is a, it's so diverse.
Physical pain is very definitely something you want free of as soon as possible. Okay? Yes, ma'am. Bobby?
Dr. Bob, you that reported out loud, that's important, evidently.
Well, I don't care whether you make it out loud, but you make it out loud to yourself.
Oh, okay.
The simple fact that I'm complaining, I'm sticking up for my rights, I'm in conflict, I don't like these people, but I'm supposed to like them, and so forth, okay? So it's clear to you that you said it. Okay? All right. Anybody else got a question, comment? Okay, you can cut that off. We'll take a break for... Okay, we'll talk about something else that maybe you won't make so important. John said, what does happen when somebody makes it important to make it interesting? So that's a good one to work on now. So we'll see if we can slow down to making it important. So I'm going to talk about the vicious cycle for a few minutes. The vicious cycle is what happens when you make things important. So we will... look at how this one works for a little bit. So the first thing, it always starts with a misconception. A misconception that this is important, this is this. I'm a victim, I'm feeling sorry for myself, which usually the person doesn't recognize, and we looked at that a little while ago, that we can just report it that way. So when a person has a misconception, sooner or later, and usually much sooner, they get a false feeling of emergency. Now, you have a true sense of emergency when a truck's about to run you down, or somebody's after you with a gun, or something else. You have a true sense of emergency, and you use physical activity to burn up the product that the misconception or the false feeling of emergency set up. But we're talking about a false feeling of emergency about 1,000 little things that happen in a day, and you have a false feeling of emergency. So the false feeling of emergency produces chemical imbalance and neuromuscular tension. Now, when you have this neuromuscular tension and the chemical imbalance, you couldn't survive very long, so this is the one where X does something about it. It's always making balance. So it comes up and produces an adaptation. Adaptation to burn up this chemical imbalance and get one back in the state of homeostasis, which is the way you're supposed to be. Now, this is the vicious cycle. Now, adaptation is that when the body begins to do something it wouldn't ordinarily do in order to burn up this neuromuscular tension. Now, we are very prone to want to go do something about that. So we go to appropriate place of whatever the person feels is appropriate to get it done. And that usually is adding some more misconception into the picture. And that brings about more false feeling emergency, brings about more of this, brings about more adaptation, and the person is getting worse.
Got it?
John? Okay. So, we'll talk about not eyes for a few minutes, and we'll discuss it for a while. A not eye is something that acts like you, but is really not you. It rattles off in your head a lot. So, one not eye is one that says that you've got to have your way right now. Another not eye is one that says, I've got to stick up for my rights. It usually says you must stick up for your rights. Another one is says you've got to please them. Another one says, believe and do as you're told by your authorities. Another one says, you've got to improve yourself. Another one says, if these other people were all right or different, I would be okay. Now, they talk a lot, and they have many faces and many ways of saying the same thing, but they say it over and over and over. And so comes along one not I and wants to tempt you a little bit. It will tell you all the reasons you should do so-and-so. And the others are all quiet. And then the minute you go ahead and do whatever the tempter said do, like tell them off or whatever, then comes the other side up. And he says, you should have known better than that. You've got to please those people, and you've got everything in the world, and they set up a big conflict. So conflict is listening to not eyes. Now, you can say that's merely a not eye, and I'm telling it to shut up. And that gets it done. I take you maybe 10 times to tell it to shut up, or it will, but it'll shut up and be quiet. And you don't have conflict then. Now, that's not too hard to see anybody.
If you can distinguish the not eyes from something else.
Well, the not eye is always saying derogatory things, and you don't say derogatory things, okay? Does that help a little bit?
No.
The not eye always is derogatory towards you or others. You are never. The real you is never derogatory towards anybody. But the not eyes are derogatory towards you or another. If they can get to picking on you, they really have fun. Make you feel guilty and worthless and a whole bunch of other things. And so you can have a slew of them. Okay?
Is that what we sometimes call a conscience?
Yeah, somebody might call it a conscience speaking to you, but it's not. Far from it.
Okay.
Far from it. It is merely a torment. And they spend a great amount of time tormenting you, trying one way and then another and then another to get you tormented and to get you to find fault with yourself or with another. Okay? So when you hear one of them talking, you merely do the little reporting on him. You say, the not I is saying so-and-so. Say exactly what he's saying. And you know it's not you. It is conditioning that's in your brain, and it works there. So if you see it, report it accurately for a few times, you can get it stopped, okay? Don't have to put up with it from now on. And you don't have to feel guilty, and you don't have to feel sorry for yourself or any of those nice things, okay? Because they're all trying to make you feel sorry for yourself, so you're a victim. Are that you are unfortunate and that you are not bright or you would have already done things and etc. And they convince you to work real hard, all this kind of stuff. Nothing to it, okay? They are merely tormentors. They are what's referred to in some places as the devil, no matter which line they're playing, okay? Got that down?
Got it.
So you don't be controlled by the devil, okay? And all their stuff is attempt to control you with that very situation. So the not eyes are tormentors, are tempters. Okay? They give you all kinds of justifications for doing things. One set of them, A does, and the B comes along after a while, after you've already done it, and gives you literal noise on it, okay? Now, you kind of understand it. You've felt it many times, practically every day of your life, okay? And you let it control what you did a lot of the time. Okay, so let's put it down to what it really is. Reported that it's just a not eye. And you can eliminate it by reporting it as what it really is. You see it for what it is, you don't justify it, you don't condemn it, you just say this is what it is. Okay? Now, I think that if all not eyes could be eliminated out of a person at once, they'd be a totally integrated being. Now, we'll talk on integration for a minute. An integrated being is when there is no conflict between the physical body, the awareness, spirit, and function. When they're all working together, that is an integrated person. They cannot work together if you listen to not eyes, because they got you in conflict between one thing and another. So let's work gently, as we said, very gently, at telling the not eye to shut up. It's simply what it is. And you know what they are, and you can get rid of them. Now, let's have conversation on the not eyes, because everybody is well acquainted with them if you know what they are. So, let's have conversation on that, okay? Questions, comments, yeah?
Okay, sometimes the not eyes seem so right. I can't keep them apart from, like, working with machines. Something that is right. And then a not I have about somebody or about myself just seems so right that
I... You're right, but it's not.
Yeah, but...
It's not right, so...
I get the two worlds confused.
So it's no matter, it's like the boy down in the restaurant a minute ago told me they had the computer was screwed up. That every time they put chili verde on it, it rung up peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. Now that seems right to the computer.
Computer not eyes.
Okay. Well,
they don't even have peanut butter and jelly sandwiches on the menu.
Well,
but it's in the program somewhere is in there, and so every time they rung up chili verde, it rung up printed out peanut butter and jelly sandwich. So it seemed right. But it's not right. So there's one thing they said to Bonnie a minute ago, that the not eyes always say derogatory things, and you never do. The real you never says anything derogatory. So now, does that help you figure it out?
Thank you.
Now, they say derogatory things about you or another. That may seem right, but it's not. Okay? You can see that now. Says derogatory thing. Yes, John.
One of the most wonderful revelations in your tapes that I've been listening to this last year, that Colleen's had for years, but is the concept that you present there about each of us has all of these things in that are equated in the scriptures, like Philistines. We all have a David and a Goliath, and they're all not eyes. Every one of these things.
That's right.
You relate back to those. And bring them into your own person and identify with that. It's really been a exceptionally nice revelation for me. I've really loved that concept.
Well, good. That's what the scripture is about. It's telling you about your inner state. And they personify it as different people.
Oh, I've talked to other people about this, though, and they don't have that concept at all, so that's a wonderful revelation. I love that.
That's all right, they will one day.
I know, but thank you for that.
Okay. Okay, another comment, question, whatever you want on it. Yes?
I was just curious on how you would work through the not eyes creating fear.
How do they create fear? That's their business. Create fear, anxiety, anger, the whole bit. All the negative emotions they work and create. So, we merely shut up. Okay? It's a derogatory statement. Anything that makes fear in you is a derogatory statement. So you tell it to shut up. And you see that it's going on. It's not true. But you feel it. And very shortly you won't feel it anymore. Okay? But just state it like it is for the time being. Okay? Yes, ma'am.
What is the relationship between not eyes in this concept and dreams, or things that you dream about, and how, or can it help you to move towards something else?
You mean when you're sound
understand,
asleep?
Understand
you're
yourself.
Sound asleep in bed at night, you're just kind of dreaming.
Yeah,
you
know? Yes,
I
right.
I really don't have any connection with it. There's maybe one dream in 10 years that really has any meaning. The rest of them are just, I don't have any dreams, but I just go to sleep. I don't have a dream. You may find that hard to believe, but I don't. I don't have a dream once.
No, I don't dream very often, but
no.
Sometimes I do.
We believe that about you. You have to have stuff in your mind to dream.
You got to have a lot in your mind to get dreams out of it. A dream is usually something that's related to something that you didn't finish thinking about the day before. You just didn't finish the thought. So it's sitting there and it goes out, finishes out dreamland. Really doesn't mean a lot.
What are the purpose of not eyes?
To destroy you.
Why would God want to do that?
Yeah. Are they physical? Are they spiritual?
No,
they're
just concepts in the brain, like a thought, a word, in your brain. And they very watching you all the time to see if they can get their word in edgewise.
Don't they be called the devil?
That's what I said a while ago.
Okay.
Yep.
Guess that's where I got it.
You got it.
You could do that. You could. But that's not a very popular word these days, so let's just leave that off. Call it not eyes and be done with it. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Dr. Boat, all this not eyes you were talking about diseases, cancer, and so forth. Where does all this fit in with all this that's put out about ecology now and what's happening to the world? Where do we fit in and not get caught up in, to be involved and yet not get...
Did you say ecology?
Ecology, yeah, all that's happening.
Well, they're the pollutant. Not eyes are the polluters. They're the pollutants. Okay. So they're the mental pollutants, and if you work with it a little bit, you can get them to quit polluting your brain and your thoughts. Okay?
So that's in the inner. How do we relate to all this that's going on in the earth?
I don't relate to it. I live at the house at the end of the road. No, none of the earth comes back there. Okay? So I don't worry about all the things that's going on in the world. I don't think it's in my business. Okay? If you find it's none of your business, it won't bother you, okay?
Okay. Jeannie? That's where the little comment comes in. Mother, you're not even trying to be good. If I live at the end of the road and don't care, don't get involved, then I'm not being a good mother.
Well, that's all right. Who wants to be a good mother anyway?
Oh, well,
you gave birth to kids that had one head, two arms, two legs, and a huge accoutrement, so you're a good mother. Now, what they do after that? I'm a joke. Okay, you're a good mother. Yes.
But if people don't get involved in issues, then won't the world be more chaotic than it is?
No, the issues die if you don't get involved in them. You gotta have somebody to get involved in to keep them alive. Did you ever notice that?
Pardon?
You gotta have people to get involved with issues to keep the issue alive. If you ignore it, it dies real quick.
You're giving the power then by just involving.
Well, sure. You can give it the power by fighting it or supporting it, either one.
Are you saying the destruction of the rainforest and politics, everything?
What can you do about it?
But if everyone feels that way, nothing.
Well, everybody does feel that way. He'll quit when you quit fighting with it. But if you fight with it, you'll give it power to keep on and keep on destroying the rainforest and what have you. Okay? Just don't get involved with it. Yes?
But then in the same way, we can make these non-eyes more powerful by fighting with them.
You fight with them. You make them far more powerful. They'd love for you to fight with them.
So the gentle way to tell them
just
to shut up is to... just observe them. Just observe them.
They're nothing to them, so just shut up. Babbling. It's nothing to you.
Or they get bigger and bigger, and then they have armies.
Then they get big crowds and they really go after you. But if you just tell them, shut up, they don't mean anything, so just quit making your noise while they will shut up. Takes a little time, but you can tell them several days, shut up, shut up, shut up, and they shut up. They have to obey you, believe it or not.
So,
Bobby?
Is it the same as apathy?
No, not the same as apathy. Go and shut up. You're interested in things. You're interested in real things, not listening to them. Okay? You can get an apathy without listening to them long enough. They can drive you nuts.
But they are there for you to use as a tool once. Wow, isn't that right?
No, I would never use them for anything. Only shut them up and get them out of the way.
Well, like, it might be to your advantage to complain once in a while.
I don't think so.
Well,
you may think so, but I don't
think
so.
Like, if you want to get a house done and the carpenter isn't working fast enough.
He won't work any faster if you yak at him. In fact, he might walk off another extra day.
He might.
No, just forget it. No, if it's derogatory, means complaining or anger or anything, let's just drop it off, okay? That's the easiest thing, dude. Just cut it off. Don't listen to it, okay? Okay? You're doing good. Keep it up. Yes, John.
Coming back to these issues, are these issues that always seem to be so involved worldwide and governments and politics and religions and
everything,
medicine and all of this stuff that's going on, is this all just a global not-I that's a distraction that we internalize to ourselves?
Yeah.
That's going that
make a big production out of it.
Global not.
And this global not I is just the devil working on whatever you want to call it.
Big scale, whatever.
On a big scale that distracts the whole world.
And get everybody into fighting on issues. Now you notice there'll be about as many on one side of the issues as the other. So just ignore the issues.
Is the whole planet an allegory the whole point is just our internal world, not the external. So
yeah.
The whole planet is an allegory.
Yeah.
Of what's happening
the internal
inside.
Thing, what you're doing inside, all the many nations and all that stuff. Yeah. All these major things that come along, you know, they were a big noise for a while, and then 2 or 3 years, they totally forgot that when they started on something else. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
So, just let them alone. Let other people take care of the issues. They'll get tired of them. So pretty soon, the issue's dead. Nothing's been done about it, but you know, they made a lot of exercise of activity over it for a while. But it's all gone.
well, especially here in America, we make this big issue of freedom.
Oh.
You know, and we think, well, if someone hadn't taken the issue to create all of this, and then we wouldn't have our freedom, and then you involute back on it again.
Yeah.
And then you try to extrapolate that to the rest of the world.
Yeah.
And it just, it's, this is just a global nada, isn't it? It's just something that just keeps going. Because God's really in charge of the whole thing anyway.
Just don't get involved with it, and it'll go away before long anyway. The least we get involved, the better it goes, the quicker it goes away. Yes, sir.
So, as well as saying derogatory things, the nadas claim that they know what is, they know what's going on.
Oh, yeah, they claim to know all sorts of things, but they're derogatory in a way. Yeah, they claim they know what's going on, the cause of everything, and all these things. It's a subtle way of being a derogatory statement. Like, that's the way the big issue starts. Because of this or this and this and this, that's why it all happened, and they tell you, you got to go out and stop it all. So the ones that says they got to have non-violent society, use violence to stop it, okay? Mm-hmm. It's all right to use violence on what they're interested in, but anything else, is they got to have non-violence.
Are they clever enough, these non-eyes, to identify with even intuition or pure, I mean, will they identify with something?
Well,
with
they
God?
Will try to. I don't know whether they'll succeed or not, but they try anything. They'll try it, yeah. They try to twist everything up, no matter what. Yes, ma'am?
Would another term for the non-eyes be ego?
The what?
Would another term for the non-eyes be ego?
Well, they're an ego, the id, and the superego, okay? They're everywhere. They try it all. Yeah, that's true. They would be part of the ego, part of the superego, part of the id. They're just in there making big noises. The id is basically 100% not us. Okay? Okay? Another comment or question? These are doing good. Keep it up. Yes, ma'am.
Just in response to what John said, you know, we talk about, we're, as a country, we fight for freedom. But
yeah.
It's really interesting, though, to look at how the non-freedom that's going within us if we honor the not-I's. So,
oh, sure.
So anyway, in the essence, it's the freedom really is within ourselves.
That's correct. You don't have to have somebody else change for you to have freedom. That's correct. I'm free. Not because somebody gave it to me, because I just do it, okay? That's all. You can't give another person freedom. You can't give it away. You can give privileges, but not freedom, okay? Yes, sir?
When I was asking about not eyes claiming to know what's going on, what did you mean by saying that that's derogatory in a way?
Well, they claim they know what's going on, and if you observe it closely enough, they're always finding this little derogatory. They're finding a little fault somewhere. They never come up and really complain about anything. They always put a little derogatory statement in it. You watch it and see. Okay? Okay, any other question? Yes, Jeannie.
I have a hard time looking at my kids without knowing that, well, this is the A side and this is the B side, and you know, and they change just to one particular changes from one side to the other, just like turning on the light.
Yeah, sure does.
How can I help him understand that that's what's going on?
Well, and
that he has the power or the
ability.
Ability to overcome them.
Well, you take your time and see a place here and there. Now, you can't go give them a whole mess of stuff once they don't buy that.
Well, then, no.
So you get one little nib of stuff in once in a month or something like that. They will grow up in spite of you, okay? They'll do it. I promise you. They'll grow up well. Okay? Yes, Bobby?
There's a common saying around here, all is well. And,
okay.
One, tell me one time, I know everything's all wrong, but that's all right. And so I'm trying to figure out now, like in this concept, if we see something wrong, we go to vote and try to make a change. I don't know what I'm trying to say, but... where do we...
Where do you find something wrong?
An idea.
Well, I don't know.
You find things you don't like, but where do you find something that's wrong?
Well, that's because I've taken on worrying about the girl again.
You're worried about what?
I get caught up...
worried about the whole world.
And things going on. I'd like the right to bear arms. Do we or should we not worry about the right to bear arms?
I don't think it makes any difference to you.
Well, see, what about the voting then?
This what?
About voting.
Why vote?
Well, did you say vote or what?
Why vote?
Why vote? just put it to X.
Yeah, just leave it alone. It'll all work out. Yes, ma'am.
So did you work hard at your inner freedom, or was it just a sudden shift in consciousness?
It just happened.
It just happened like that?
Yeah, one day when I quit fighting everything, it was there. I was free. When you quit fighting, you're free. As long as you're fighting, well, you're free. You're in bondage. You're in bondage to something. When you're fighting, right? So let's just... quit fighting, and it's all there anyway. You already have freedom, you just don't know it yet. Yes, Marcia?
Most of the time, we don't really fight. What we do is complain within ourselves.
Well, that's kind of a form of fighting, isn't it?
Yes, but you're not really doing anything.
Not really going out. You're just complaining and making noises. Yep, I know what it's like. Most people don't do anything about all these great issues. They just complain about them. Mm-hmm. So what? Okay. Other question? Yes, Jeannie?
Bob, could you give me a formula or an argument? I am a member of a family that is so... they know right and wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I just shut up and let them believe what they want to believe. However,
right.
when they come to me in my home and start telling me that one of the things that is wrong with this society nowadays is that there is no wrong, how can I come back to them? Because I
don't. Why come back? Ignore it.
Don't fight. Huh?
You don't have to defend yourself.
Well, no, I'm not trying to defend myself. I'm just trying to point out that
they have
the
a fallacy in their
faith. I'm not going to make them believe the way I do.
So just ignore it, okay? They'll shut up a little bit.
Yeah.
I think so often we feel like we have to qualify something.
Oh, yeah.
And we just let it.
Just let it flow. It's all right. It's just flowing on. It's immaterial. Let it be. It's like somebody comes in and tries to tell you what's right and what's wrong, and you feel there's a difference. But just ignore them. They'll go away after a while. Don't have to fight with them. Don't have to defend yourself, huh?
But see, one of the hang-ups that I have is that I don't want, Jeannie doesn't want that person over there to think that Jeannie is, that they have something over on me. You know what I mean?
Well, that's just one of your little hang-ups, that you feel somebody's trying to do something to you. It's all right. Well, think anything you want to. They're going to think it anyway, no matter how much you contend it. So just let it be. Yes, ma'am.
In this context, we were discussing this subject, and he said, well, don't you believe in patriotism? I said, no, I don't believe in motherhood or an apple pie either.
Okay.
Take your sales pitch somewhere else.
Let it put somewhere else. All right. Don't believe in anything. Okay? Okay? Any more questions, comments? Okay, let's take about 15-minute break, and we'll be back at 2 o'clock, okay? We'll talk to this moment about the four forces. Maybe it gives us a little understanding of how everything goes. You know, ordinarily we talk about cause and effect. Now, I don't think there is such thing as cause and effect. There is four things involved. The four forces that are involved in things that you would ordinarily call cause and effect. The first one is initiative. You initiate something and it gets started. Then comes a resistance. It always is there either as active or passive resistance. And most people call that active or passive resistance bad luck, interference, terrible things happen, etc., etc. But they really have to be there. So the resistance is viewed by the unwary as being unfortunate, and they feel not a place to be a victim, you know, had a second force come along. Or they can feel sorry for themselves because of it and so forth. But there has to be a resistance. For instance, if you were going to make an iron pot, so you would initiate it by melting the iron. And then you've got to have a mold to pour it in, and that mold is a resistance to the iron. Now, we wouldn't call that bad luck, would we? It's got to be there. Then you get the form, which is the physical manifestation of your initiation and the resistance. Without the resistance, you wouldn't have the form. Form could be literal form, or it could be a psychological form. And then there is the result of the situation. And that's what we're usually interested in when we initiate it. So we don't think of this resistance and form as being involved, so we don't see anything except cause-effect. And only thinking in terms of cause-effect, we're frequently all upset by this second force or resistance that comes along. But it has to be there. Now, if you wanted to go to Boise today, you have a passive resistance of distance. It takes you a while to get there. Now, sometimes there's snow and ice on the road, more active one. you at least have the passive resistance of time, a distance there. And the form is that you're traveling and then you get there. So we always have, and it's necessity to have this second force of resistance there, or you would never have any result. So suppose we could begin to look at it as a very nice logical thing to have resistance. It's supposed to be there, has to be there. It's what we get paid for, really, is through the second resistance, the second force. That's what we get paid for, doing things. And really, it's not a lot of effort to do around it as long as you know what it is. It's not obnoxious or bad or something to feel sorry for yourself or be a victim over. It is simply that that is a part of nature, that you have a resistance. And that resistance makes things kind of worthwhile. It gives them strength, it gives them form, it gives shape to things. Now, if we resist it and start fighting with it, that's what we get. We can have a terrible time with it, doing all the resistance and everything, and doing the fighting with the second force. But if we take it for what it is and it belongs there, then it is not obnoxious at all. It is natural. Natural is breathing. It's there. And so you have a far different existence without all the turmoil of feeling sorry for ourselves and being victimized by it and so forth. You see it as part of the creative process. So without resistance, there's no creativity. So if you go in to beautify someone's home, you got a lot of resistance there, huh? But that's a part of it. That's correct. That's a part of it. One thing is the lady of the house has many ideas that you don't want her to have, so that's part of the resistance. And you have to get those straightened around. And then there's resistance of getting walls down, corners down, and etc.
Limited money.
And the money and all these things, there's all resistance to it. But that's part of the creative process of getting it all done properly. So we always find it's here. So I think if we could report that whenever we initiate anything, there's going to be a resistance. And we kind of look for the resistance, expect it, see it, knowing that's what we get paid for. And that's what takes the time, the job, or whatever. So that's what we get paid for. So we could be appreciating this second force in the scheme of things. We call it merely second force. It's there. And we could enjoy it, appreciate it, and not feel all victimized and self-pity over having all these resistance things go on, which was the very essential part of it, of anything that we go to do. Now we've talked on that for a minute. Let's everybody talk for a minute, okay? Somebody got a word to throw in here? Yes?
Would you talk about using the resistance?
You don't use it, you just see it.
No, you talked to me about this before, about using.
Yeah, you use it because you see that that's what you're being paid for, is to deal with the second force. And so that's what your revenue comes from. So why not just use it for the source of revenue? Okay? Yeah, Diane, that's
what you... somebody else's resistance. It seems to me that I... say too that you can turn it to your own use toward waking up.
That's very true. You can report on how appreciative you are of it. That's what you wake up, see? That's the way it works. So use it to your advantage. Instead of using it to your disadvantage of feeling you're a victim or sorry for yourself, you see that that's what's valuable in the situation and you appreciate it. Okay? You about to say something there? Well, you want to formulate?
Is part of the parable of the mustard seed the actual description of various intensities of resistance?
Yeah.
I mean, it wasn't just that it fell on sandy
soil and it didn't do nothing. It dried up, the birds eat it up. Some fell on the shallow soil, sprung up quickly, and was all gone at the first resistance that come by. That's what it says, first resistance come by. They got all torn up about it.
But even deep soil would be heavy resistance, but it makes
but
the greatest strength.
Yeah, but the plant has to have that soil in order to resist, or it would only grow out to be a sprout and never have any root in itself, and that's the end of it. If you ever was around where the potatoes were stored, and they grow out a long sprout reaching towards the light, maybe as far as from here to the back door there, but it'll never make a plant. Because it doesn't have the resistance of the soil to push against to make a root system and so forth. So it's there. Yes, Bobby?
I just, while you're saying this, I'm remembering my friends, the Hopi Indians, that save seeds when we're on a trip of the peaches, special peaches and things that they like. And then old David went back and he would take these seeds up and they'd plant them 15 inches down in the soil.
Uh-huh.
And they'd have not very tall trees, but they'd have prolific with fruit. But they had to resist, or fight all this resistance to get up and get strong.
Right.
That deep.
So that was the best thing for the peach tree, wasn't it? Yeah. Okay. So the tree didn't set and moan because it was buried deep in the soil or anything. It appreciated it. Well, that's the whole idea, to appreciate second force, okay? All right, another question, comment? Yes, ma'am.
Which one was the form again?
What is the form?
Mm-hmm.
Well, the form was the tree that she just mentioned. The form was something you would pour metal into to make a pot or a container. Some of it is merely the form at the process takes to do the job, whatever it is, it gets the job. You got a form there. A house in some cases, building in some cases, whatever thing that begins to be a visible form. Okay? Doesn't matter what it is. Yes,
well, it seems to me then that the attitude of gratitude is about taking care of the picture of man.
That does it beautifully.
If you can remember.
Well, we can remember, so let's keep it up. The attitude of gratitude for all the things that happen because a lot of them are second force. That's correct. Yes, ma'am.
I'm curious, how would you explain where the first force is initiated from? If it's
that's out of your head. Out of anybody's head. Somebody's head. You always read up
the
first.
Is it a need that precipitates it? Or?
No, it may not be a need. It may be simply an interest. It may be something else that you want to do. Okay?
It's interesting how they just kind of spark up.
It's what it does. And it may be in response to a result down here. Because it starts another cycle of initiative resistance, passive result right there. But ordinarily, it just flops in your head. That's where it comes. You decide to build a house. And sometimes it takes you 15 years to get around to it, right, Bonnie? But finally, one day, you just start it.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. Correct? So, you're going to create something and you just had a whim to do it, okay? So it may be a whim, okay? Whatever the reason, that's what it does. Yes?
If resistance ever seems inordinate, is it ever sort of inspiration telling you to stop this initiation? Or could it be to fight it hard? It's never telling you to stop.
No, I'm never telling you to stop, but you do that over your own.
Just creatively try to get around it and
yeah, go under it, over it, around it, whatever you're using, some way or other.
Not a warning, ever.
Yes,
my understanding of what you're saying here about this resistance, this second force, it's kind of an
twist on what I understood the second force was before. The second force is kind of the opposition, but
it's not an opposition.
If we do something, we create almost everything that we do creates a second force to somebody else.
Well, to you or to somebody else.
But that's not necessarily bad. I thought that I was considering before that was kind of a, you don't want to bring a resistance to anybody else, but I've considered before how you do anything without creating some resistance to someone else.
You gotta create resistance, some horse along the way, anytime you initiate something, okay?
To yourself or someone else.
Yourself or someone else.
That's not necessarily bad.
Not bad, not good, it just is. Okay? Not good, not bad, just is. It's the nature of things, but it's where most people wind up feeling sorry for themselves or feeling victimized because second force existed. They never heard of it, they only thought of cause and effect. But when you really see what the creative process has four steps in it, and one of them is resistance, and it's necessary for the creation of the finished product. So it's not any reason to feel sorry for yourself or to be feel victimized or anything. It's just simply part of nature, the way things work. Go down and drive your boat on Lake Powell, you have the resistance of the water against the force of the engine. If you just had the engine sitting out in midair, it'd just spin itself to death anyway. Wouldn't go anywhere. Right? So you're going for a boating trip. First off, you initiate it by starting the boat, but then comes resistance, which is essential.
No, the resistance is your wife. That's the resistance. That's
well,
it.
No.
I'm just kidding. That's a joke. That's a joke.
Part of it.
We'll talk about four forces now.
Give him heart. Keep it going. You can be his resistance.
I'm going to demonstrate this.
I'll demonstrate this program. Okay. Okay. Another comment, question? Another one of your self-pities and your victimizations went for the wayside. Okay? You have to forget about resistance, second force, or you will have no resistance. Okay? Have nothing to feel sorry for yourself about. Okay? We'll knock this one off. I'll talk about something else. That's it. So, let's look at some of the attributes of a conscious person. We won't try to look at them all, we'll just look at some of them. So I think possibly the number one attribute of a conscious person, you'd never find them upset. Okay? There is nothing to get agitated about. Nothing to be upset about. Right?
Not conscious.
Huh?
I'm sorry.
Yeah, constantly. Constantly be non-upset. Okay? Nothing to get upset about. Give me a for instance that you think you have to be upset.
Well, let's see. Somebody calls up but wants to know about the stock. You can't find the stock. You don't understand it when you hear about it.
Okay, so that's not anything to get upset about.
No.
No, not anything to get upset about. Look around and try to find the stuff after a while. Time nothing's happening because you haven't found it. Is that right?
Well, I'm not sure.
Well,
maybe.
He may be making it important, but you're not, so.
God, I don't know.
Don't make it important, so the person doesn't make anything important, is not upset, okay? Looks at things gently and freely. Looks at it like it really is, because they look at it gently, not all agitated, so they can't see straight. Okay? They work, but they don't work at high speed, get in a hurry, no hurry. Okay? No hurry. Deliberate movements. Okay? And they don't listen to all the propaganda that's put out in the world. Okay, none of it. They don't get caught up in causes. They're peaceful and serene. They do things for the joy of doing it, not because they have to. Now, they may not like everything they do, but they do it because they want to, for one reason or another.
Run that one by again.
Huh?
Run that one by again. There, you don't like everything.
May not like doing everything, but they see some reason for doing it, so they do it deliberately and freely. Okay. Now then, we give you a few samples on these. Let's hear from everybody else as to what their idea of a conscious person would be.
Harmless.
Harmless, okay.
Contribution.
Make a contribution, be harmless. Be what to them is a good guess, I guess would be simply settle that down pretty well. What else?
They might be single-minded purpose in whatever they're doing.
That's correct. Single-minded while they were doing it. Not trying to jump on their horse and ride off in all directions at the same time. Single-minded and serenely single-minded. Any more contributions to what this person be like? The conscious individual, conscious human being, yes?
Well, they wouldn't know what to be for everybody else.
That's for sure, and are probably for themselves either, but they sure wouldn't know what ought to be for everybody else.
Avoid ideals.
Avoid ideals. Don't get caught up in them.
These people would be judgmental.
Wouldn't be what?
They wouldn't be judgmental.
No, they wouldn't be sentimental either. Sentimental or judgmental, okay?
Then what is the difference between being sentimental and compassionate or having empathy?
Well, having empathy or compassionate is willing to do anything you can. Sentimentality is just a damn crap about it.
I didn't catch that. What was the last word?
Sentimental is to just sit down and cry because you were got a pain in your elbow. I'm going to sit and cry about it. If I was making a contribution or working towards it, I'd do what I could for your elbow. If I couldn't do anything, I'd try to help you get somewhere else, but I wouldn't get all that sentimental and sit and cry about it. Okay? Mm-hmm. Sentimentality is just get down and cry and blubber about it.
Get stuck there.
So a lot of people are sentimental and very few are really doing it. Okay.
Would not speak in the name of I.
No, that's probably right. I don't come up with a big I or anything. Yes.
Well, you probably, I probably wouldn't get angry at other drivers or other people as part of that.
No, it's for sure you would. You would have agape. You see, they were doing what they felt was right, proper, and justifiable, and that's it. So the prime word in it is agape, that they see that the other person is doing what they feel is right, proper, and justifiable, and that's why I do things, is because I feel they're right, proper, and justifiable. So why get angry at somebody else because they're doing the same thing I am? Maybe they can justify something I can't or whatever, but that's immaterial. Okay.
What is the what would be the definition of doing virtuous acts as opposed to trying to be a do-gooder for other people?
Well, virtuous acts would be what you did naturally because you were interested in it, not because you felt you should or ought to, or this would be a thing to do or whatever. You just treat people with simple good manners, I'd say. I think that's one of the good words, is simple good manners. Okay, you see the idea of this? As long as some of you are making notes, you can continue on those notes for a few days, okay? And see what you find in them that would be most useful to you. Okay? Now then, I will ask you to tell me what subject you would like to discuss now. Yes, sir.
Sharing these ideas with children.
Sharing the ideas with children. Well, number one, I think that the best way to share it with a child is to be acting it out. Acting the idea out. In other words, if I try to tell a child about the ideas, but I'm continually being a victim or continually feeling sorry for myself, the child's going to go by what he feels, not what he heard. Okay? And if we was going to do the conscious person, as we looked at here, we would be actualizing those in our behavior around the child all the time so that the child would pick that up as a natural way to behave. It's like they picked up the language of their parents and etc. when they were little folks. You know, if we went to learn a foreign language today, we would be hard put to get it down. We'd have to work a lot to get it, and never would be efficient. But the kid does that with the greatest of ease. He's born, never heard a word. Now he sits it up and does it because that's what he heard. Now if he hears a lot of profanity in the conversations, you can tell him the evils of profanity and everything, but he's going to use it. That's what he's heard, that's what he's mimicking. So the child learns by mimicking more than any other word, any other way, than all the concepts and precepts we can put on him. So let's let him have a good, well, let's be a good demonstration to him. Does that make any sense to you? That's one we'd use. That'd get it close to him quicker than anything on the sun if we could do in any way possible. Yes, sir.
What would you feel would be valuable or useful or worthwhile spiritual experiences as opposed to false experiences that are assumed to be spiritual?
Well, I think first the person would look at what really is spiritual, which is some of the things we've discussed today. And it wouldn't be trying for a spiritual experience. When you're trying for them, you're liable to have some false ones. If you're not trying and you're just living a natural, we said, easy life, you're liable to have a real one. If you have a real one, you probably won't want to tell anybody about it. If you have false ones, you want to tell everybody. That's pretty good, but I'll wait and tell the difference. Because if you had a real one, you wouldn't know how to talk about it. And a false one, why, you can come up with all kinds of words, tell people all about it, how wonderful it was, etc. But the real one, you have no words for. So you just be quaint. Okay, what other subject you want here?
Bob, do you ever talk about, besides the Master Jesus Christ, there are a lot of masters that have lived on the earth.
Yeah, and so-called anyway.
Okay, but are there some, I mean, you know, there are a lot of things we could read or do that are just of interest. Mm-hmm. Would you ever care to just share who some of these, you know, like...
people are?
Uh-huh.
Well, some of them you would have never heard of, so the name wouldn't mean anything. I'd rather not.
Would you
reason being, if I gave you somebody's name that's fairly well known, you'd say I was interested in that cult or something like that. I'm not. The point is that the person who is living this kind of a life is a pretty good example, and you would recognize it. Okay? So if you ever run into them, the others you don't run into, you'd be rusty to try to find them. But I'd rather not, okay? All right?
Yes.
I'm not trying to be coy or anything. It just is not productive. Okay? Thank you for the idea anyway, but we'll bite on that one. Okay? Yes, ma'am.
What do you think about those subliminal tapes?
Subliminal tapes. They're hypnosis.
So how does that work towards
putting
you further asleep? Can you kind of go into detail on that?
How does it work to do what?
To put you further asleep instead of waking
up. Well, it's continual suggestion. Subliminal, but the suggestion is there, and so you pick up the suggestion because you really don't have the opportunity to refute it, even if it was one that you would ordinarily refute. You just accept the suggestion because it's done it below the conscious level there a little bit. So it's just a hypnotic trip. That's all right. You want to be hypnotized? We'll get you some subliminal tapes. I'd at least, if I was going to be hypnotized, I'd want to know generally what the hypnotist was going to use, and those you don't. But there's something to play with, like a lot of other people. Okay?
More on this. Okay, so you really feel that being hypnotized is not harmful?
No.
No.
Not necessarily. It can be. Can be very harmful.
Under what circumstances?
Well, I'll tell you for instance, okay? As a young man I know, and he went to a hypnotist in school. And the man said he could hypnotize people to, you know, the ordinary statements. You can't hypnotize a person to do something their ordinary morals would left. So this man hypnotized him and told him that if he was broke, it was grounds for stealing. So he got married one day, and he went off on his honeymoon, stayed at a Holiday Inn in some town, I don't know where, and he decided he was broke, so he went up to the front desk and held up the establishment, and went away feeling it was perfectly all right. Of course, he got picked up and put in jail for 2 years, and when he got out, he did a very similar thing again, and again, and again. And the last time I knew of him, he'd spent 18 years in prison and 1 year out being sent back. All because it was justifiable by the hypnotist for him to steal if he was broke. I would say that was somewhat harmful.
Well, what about, there are a lot of people that get into hypnosis towards a spiritual awakening.
Pooey. That's all I got to say. You deal with hypnosis all you want, but don't try to sell it to me. I won't buy it.
So it's really putting you sounder asleep instead of waking you up.
That's absolutely correct. You can't wake a person up by putting him to sleep. But I know it's that. Can't get anybody awake by putting them to sleep. It has its values in a very limited way in certain places under very controlled circumstances, but not under mass numbers. It's not appropriate to me. Okay?
Is that harmful?
Yeah.
It is.
I would say so. I just told you once. I could tell you 100 more, but I'm not going to. But I'd rather wake up and be awake 1 minute than to be do some phenomena under hypnosis for an hour or so. It's the easy way out, supposedly.
Is there a way to recognize when you're being hypnotized? I hear that some department stores will put subliminal messages on their music.
That's very true.
To get people to
you don't know it.
No way to...
No, it's called covert hypnosis. They don't let you know what's happening. Overt hypnosis says, well, we're going to hypnotize you and go through a routine. Covert hypnosis is done without your knowledge. It is particularly obnoxious in my book. But certain stores do put subliminal messages on their music in the store. Says, buy this, buy that, buy the other thing, so on. So, no, you don't always know it. Okay.
So you fall right into that, not really?
Yeah, you can fall into that nonsense right away if you wanted to. But I don't think any real legitimate store would put it on there, but I know it's done. Okay?
Would you talk about the divine? Talk about X just a little.
About what?
Talk about X. Talk about the divine for a minute.
Well, when we talk about the conscious person, we're talking about manifestations of the divine. We don't know what the divine is like. That's why we call it X. We know only that it does the appropriate thing for the information it receives. It apparently has no sentimentality or anything of the sort to try to please you no matter what. It just goes for what information it receives. Okay? And if we give it the kind of information that we would call spiritual, it does beautiful things. If we told it to rob a bank, it would do a good job of it. If we told it to kill somebody, it would do a good job of that. I don't see X as having personal preferences. I don't think it has that at all. But it will do anything that it is given the correct information about, or incorrect information. Or as that, it goes on that too. So I think it behooves us to be careful as to what we're given this tremendous power. I think that's the part that's divine about it, that it behooves us to be conscious, aware of what's going on so that we don't give it false information for it to act upon, because it will. Okay? Is that enough said about it? That's about as far as I can go on. It's...